House Republicans do not want to see any more, as they called it, gimmicks. They don't want to see Senate Republicans trying to insert emergency funding as they had tried to earlier to get funding, you know, more defense funding. Right. A lot of the defense hawks were really unhappy with the levels, other things. So the big question is, you know, how are they going to come together? It looks a little bit better than it had before, but there's still a lot of questions. And, you know, once again, we don't have a lot of time to do this. 12 appropriation bills, that's a lot. And they have, you know, January, mid-January to beginning of February for some of these things. Or they're at risk of an across-the-board cut to a lot of their programs if they do not get what they need to get done. And Speaker Johnson has threatened that that could be the reality.
Welcome to Reporter's Notebook, where we talk to the Washington Examiner's top journalists about the stories breaking on their beats. I'm Jim Antle. I'm joined today by congressional reporter Samantha-Jo Roth. So happy holidays. We didn't have a government shutdown, at least not this month. Not yet. But there's still a lot of infighting about what a spending deal is going to look like and what things are going to be funded and what things are going to be left out. What's sort of the status right now?
Well, I think, you know, things are really in limbo. You do have a understanding from the House Freedom Caucus finally that they are not going to get as deep of cuts as they had originally said. If you remember back in June, I believe it was, you know, Biden and former House Speaker Kevin McCarthy, they came together and they decided what those top budget levels were going to be. And House Freedom Caucus said, we don't support that, and came and turned around and said, we want $1.47 billion as our top line, which is significantly less than what some of the Republicans had agreed to. So now there is an understanding that they are not going to get that, that they need to adhere to what, you know, Republicans had already agreed on with the president. You know, the big question is with the two chambers, House Republicans do not want to see any more, as they called it, gimmicks. They don't want to see Senate Republicans trying to insert emergency funding as they had tried to earlier to get funding, you know, more defense funding. A lot of the defense hawks were really unhappy with the levels, other things. So the big question is, you know, how are they going to come together? It looks a little bit better than it had before, but there's still a lot of questions. And you know, once again, we don't have a lot of time to do this. 12 appropriation bills, that's a lot. And they have, you know, January, mid-January to beginning of February for some of these things. Or they're at risk of an across-the-board cut to a lot of their programs if they do not get what they need to get done. And Speaker Johnson has threatened that that could be the reality.
So the spending stalemates aren't really the only things holding things up in the Senate, but maybe Senator Tommy Tuberville, the Alabama Republican who's been doing the holds of Pentagon nominees and promotions, maybe some things might be easing on that front?
Yeah, it definitely sounds like, I mean, the senator hasn't specifically said he will drop the holds, but today he was really signaling that that is going to potentially be happening next week. I mean, there is a lot of pressure, and it's not just from Democrats. His own party is pretty fed up. I mean, we've spoken with dozens of senators this week who have said, you know, Republican senators who have said that this has caused a lot of issues, and there's got to be a way to move forward with this, you know, the holds. Basically, Senator Schumer, the majority leader, had threatened to, you know, put in place a mechanism to temporarily change the rules and advance some of these nominees forward. And it's really starting to seem like a lot of Republicans would actually vote for that. And that is very embarrassing for them. So I think there was an understanding at Senate lunch this week that Tuberville has got to drop some of these holds, or he's going to be very embarrassed by his party because some of them are threatening to vote for this. So I think it sounds very likely that he's going to drop some of these holds before it ever gets to this point. Although he has said that, you know, he's still going to hold nominees that he sees as woke. So it's not a full dropping of all these holds, but he's saying, you know, that I think it sounds like it's about to be over.
Which we'll get a new woke hold instead.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And it's been 10 months. It's a long time. That's impacting a lot of military families. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a recognition among Republicans that this is a real problem for their party.
So you're starting to see some fissures among congressional Democrats over U.S. aid to Israel and what the United States response should be to the Hamas attack in Israel in October. And Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer gave a speech this week. What did he have to say?
Well, so he gave a very, long and intense speech about the growing anti-Semitism in America. And I think a lot of folks did not draw some of the same conclusions that I saw. Mm-hmm. And I saw, there were several instances where he was calling out the left, specifically young protesters who maybe don't know the history of Jewish persecution and oppression across centuries. And so he was, really imploring some of these protesters to look at the history and understand what, Jews have been suffering with. And also just the fact that there has been so many incidents since October 6th. There's been, protests where people are holding swastikas. Mm-hmm. There was a young woman who was murdered and, just shot dead in Michigan. Mm-hmm. So, there's a lot of different anti-Semitic things. And so I think basically Senator Schumer is trying to send a message to his party, specifically the, far left fringe, right, saying that they need to really take a look at the history and not just, look at what they're seeing on social media. And, this has been something that we've been talking about for a long time. Democrats, specifically the far-leaning, left-leaning, have been very sympathetic to not necessarily Hamas, but right, the Palestinian cause. Right. And so he was really imploring folks to, obviously he didn't want to see hate of anybody, not sure, Palestinians, not Jews, but also talking about not specifically blaming Jewish people who are in America for what Israel is doing. Mm-hmm. He didn't speak at all about a ceasefire. He didn't speak at all about some of these conditions that some other Democrats had been pushing for, but it was mostly about anti-Semitism and just really a message to the left about the fact that they are fueling some of this.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, SJ.
Thank you.
You can read Samantha-Jo and the rest of our political team's coverage at washingtonexaminer.com.